saltwater leg of the Triangle Route lies along the coast of British Columbia and Alaska. The queen ship in this service is the Canadian National Steamship Prince George, and her northern terminus is Skagway. Skagway is at the beginning of the Trail of 98, the trail from the coast to the gold fields of the Klondike. The rock wall by the dock carries grim monuments to desperadoes like Sophie Smith, who ruled the town half a century ago when the gold seekers flocked through in thousands. Skagway is 500 miles from the gold fields, but some of the greatest fortunes were made right here, at the gambling table. For us, the trail back through the mountains is easy. While the Prince George remains over for 2 days, we can take a train from the dock to West Taku Arm, or a train from the middle of town to Whitehorse, 110 miles away in the Yukon. The tracks are laid in the footsteps of the gold seekers. The hardships of the trail are not for us. Up from Skagway into the mountains, our train is hardly visible as it winds around the edge of the hill. The White Pass and Yukon route is a narrow gauge railway. The train itself is small, enabling it to get enough traction to climb to the top of the pass. From Skagway to Summit, it must pull itself up 3,000 feet in 20 miles. The mountains are serene and inviting in summer. But these passes were full of misery in the winter of 98. Here is Chilkoot Pass, where many weaker souls were left to die in the snow. Here is Dead Horse Gulch, where hundreds of pack animals had to be left because they could not follow the men over the jagged rocks. We stop for a few minutes at Inspiration Point, where a monument has been erected to the pack animals. The dead are speaking. In memory of us 3,000 pack animals that laid our bones on these awful hills during the gold rush of 1898. From Inspiration Point, we can look back down to the sea, 2,000 feet below us. As we start up again, the way becomes more and more precipitous, until we wonder that man was ever able to conquer these rugged peaks. Our little engine looks like a toy, but it runs rings around the mountains, chugging steadily through the sliced rock till it reaches the top of the pass. Thank you. top of the climb, at a steel cantilever bridge 215 feet high. In many places we can see the trail of the weary gold seeker. This narrow brown path, scene of so much hardship and disappointment, seems pathetic now. Our faithful train stops for a well-earned drink at Summit, the top of White Pass. This is the international boundary between Alaska and Canada, and also the watershed. The water divides here, some going only 20 miles to the sea at Skagway, some flowing 2,000 miles to the Bering Sea. As we move on, we skirt Summit Lake, downhill now through British Columbia. Through a great plateau strewn with boulders left by glaciers. Past Beaver Lake. Past Lake Linderman to Lake Bennett. We stop at Bennett for lunch. By telegraph, the cook has been told how many there are on the train, and a hot meal is already served, waiting for us at the table. Bennett had a population of 10,000 in 1898, but now nothing remains but the shell of a church that looks down the length of the lake. We are ready to start again, and now for 26 miles we follow the shore of Lake Bennett. Across the lake, we have a good view of Pencil Falls, and nearby is a sign marking the boundary between the province of British Columbia and Yukon Territory. The next stop is Carcross, Yukon. And there is a welcome for us at this colorful little spot. Here, some of the passengers take the steamer Tushai down West Kaku Arm. There are many things to see in Carcross. The first engine used on the railway. Fine Indian handicrafts made in Carcross. And magnificent dogs, Malamutes and Siberian Huskies, bred for carrying packs or pulling sleighs in the winter. This mother has brought her puppies, papoose fashion, to the train to see us off as we start on the last lap of the journey to Whitehorse. Railway ends at Whitehorse, largest town in the Yukon. Since the war, almost a boom town again. The Alaska Highway passes nearby, and Whitehorse is also an important air center. Whitehorse is fast becoming a modern city, but like all frontier towns, the population is predominantly male. The log cabin of the old days is still standard. Now they are beginning to double them up to save space. This is probably the only place in the world where you will find a three-story log cabin. The RCMP barracks was a busy place in the old days, and this log church had Robert Service as treasurer. This cabin is said to have been occupied by the immortal Sam McGee, and beside it is an old longboat used for shooting the rapids. The Royal Mail was carried by stagecoach, wherever there was a road. Main Street is up to date, and the stores are stocked with modern wares. But They also carry beautiful Indian work and curios from the old days. One of these stores is owned by a retired riverboat captain. He used to guide a paddle wheeler through the perilous waters of the Yukon River, carrying miners to and from the gold fields. The boats were gay then, full of music and laughter from the gambling saloon. But now the Bonanza King and the Yukoner sit on the shore, stripped of their glitter. Near White Horse, the Yukon roars through Miles Canyon, where the rock walls tighten on the river, causing rapids that claimed many lives during the stampede for gold. A little further along, White Horse Rapids display the foaming waters that gave White Horse its name. The country holds no terror now, and modern chechakos come north to paint its beauty. Once past White Horse, the river is more easily navigable. The paddle wheelers still fight its swirling waters, down north to Dawson City. Where the Klondike River flows into the Yukon, in the heart of the gold country, lies Dawson City, administrative center of the territory. In the 8 years of the Klondike Rush, $100 million were taken out of its gold fields. Robert Service's cabin is visited every year by thousands of travelers. Ghosts of the gold rush walk the streets of Dawson, looking for the old-time gaiety. Dance halls and the gambling saloons are closed and falling down. The day of the pioneer seems to be gone. The crude oil lamps have been replaced with neon signs. But basically, the far north hasn't changed. The spirit of the Trail of 98 is still there. And out beyond the neon signs, the hills are the same. The midnight sun still lights the way to adventure in a land beautiful beyond imagination.